So here with Max Brandrett, who is the copyist and all things to the art world, aren't you, Max? And you've been on before, and I know you've got an update. And for this episode of the Vote, we're going to be talking a bit about what's been happening over the last, what is it, 2 years? Because I think last time we met, was way before lockdown.
It's 2 years since we sat on this very chair.
Yeah.
And I was very humble, selling ceramic ducks to the eBay. which were forgeries, as you do. It changed my life coming down here, and it's been magnificent. It's been really, really good. And I've got a book coming out, written by a scriptwriter called Tony Valentine, and it's all about the stories. I'm not so much, look, I was a forger, yes, years ago, but today you cannot get away with forgeries anymore because there's too much technology up there. So, you know, I was that guy, but I'm no longer doing that. I'm Max Brandrett, signing everything, copies of Caravaggio, Ertes, Louis Wain's, Feinecker's, a Coolidge I love. You know Coolidge with the dogs playing poker?
Yeah.
That's what I do.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I want to sort of know people to know my early days, as we said before, born in Buckingham Road, in a basement flat, and in the book I say how it really happened. You think Buckingham Road is up near the station. Can you picture this? Coming down the basement steps was a guy that looked like a park keeper, and then another lady looked like something out of the 40s, you know, a Miss Gibson. And they looked at us. We were very scraggy. I was the only one with shoes, for goodness sake. My other brothers didn't have shoes. We couldn't go to school. But what I like to get across, my mum was Yorkshire. My mum used to say, don't stand up a bloody wet week. Came with a cup of tea and a fag. My mum was like that. She cleaned the steps every Sunday, as they used to do.
Yeah.
And it was, I had a script the other day from wants to do a film. And he made my mother look as if it was some Dickens character from bloody Bleak House. And I didn't like that. So I went no to that. And but my mum was brilliant. It was a one bedroom flat, and we had five of us there. I did have shoes. We used to share the shoes. Isn't that crazy? You can't go to school because Joey's wearing your shoes today. Weird as that. And in this script said, and Max was sitting in the corner eating Weetabix in water. That wasn't true. I didn't eat Weetabix in water. It wasn't that bad. But then suddenly they came to me, Mr. Odin said to me, come on, Max, come on, boys, get yourself together. Don't forget, we'd never, ever had proper trousers without holes in them. So they threw these grey uniforms to us, and then suddenly, I've never had clothes like this, a jumper and a shirt without tatters and holes in it. So suddenly whisked off in a Morris Minor, travelling up to a place called Barking, at the Barkingside Village Homes. And we arrived there, and a guy, and I've got a good memory, you know, we probably get that. Mr. Castle said, hello, boys, you're going to be here with us for a few months, whatever. And he walked me across the road at this green, they're all cottages. Barkingside was full of cottages, you know, like Honeythorn, Angus. He said, Max, you're going to Joy Cottage, and Tony, you're going to Honeythorn. I said, why is that, sir? He said, well, you do have a problem, Max, because you wet the bed, don't you? I went, no, I don't, sir. He said, yes, you do. So he put me into this cottage with all the wet beds. And do you know what their cure was?
What?
They used to, if you were dry for 7 days, you could move to another cottage. But so I kept dry on after the seventh week. I was dry for 6 days. On the very day to be let, I pissed the bed. Oh, so I wet the bed.
Yeah, wet the bed.
I wet the bed. But then I thought, oh no, please, please don't do that. So they gave me another chance. And then what happened, the next night I did wet the bed, but what happened, the guy used to come round with called the night watchman, George Armour, used to take the boys out of the bed and take them to the loo. So this guy next to me called Dougie Banks was still dry. So I swapped sheets, didn't I? I swapped the sheets with him. So I took his dry ones.
And he had to stay in the cottage.
And he had the stained one, yeah.
Yeah.
And then their cure next morning. So Ma'am Stanley, a lady with massive big body, right?
Yeah.
Came out and she used to come into the dormitory. Good morning, boys. 1, 2, 3, out. So she pulled all the bedclothes. She came to me, she went, "Well done, Max. You've done so well. You can go and join your brother in Honeythorn." She got to Dougie Banks. She went, "You dirty boy." He said, "How can you do that?" So their cure, he had to go downstairs in a tin bath in front of all the other boys and wash his sheets in cold water. That was one of their cures.
Barking, there's still Barnardo's. Yeah. They're still based. They have places in Barking.
Yeah.
You're talking about Dagenham Barking.
Barkingside. Yeah.
Barkingside,
the first Dr. Barnardo's home.
Yeah. And I think they've still got something there as well, haven't they?
Yeah, well, they're not. It's not a home for children anymore. No. It's a clearinghouse. They get foster parents. But we were there. We were there for about a year. Then they moved us to Watts Naval Training School.
Yeah.
Very, very naval. Then we went to Barsham Rectory. We were fostered out to the Reverend Soden. Do you know Barsham Rectory was where Nelson's mother was born? We were there with the Reverend Soden and a housekeeper called Mr. and Mrs. Fish.
Yeah.
And I loved it. That was, and then, you know, yeah, we moved around.
How did you get into the art? Then did you always have an interest in art?
Yeah,
I know we spoke about this before, but I mean, when did that first?
I think when I was because we didn't have TV or radio. We had a radio, but we didn't have TV. I used to spend my days drawing caricatures, you know, Mickey Mouse and all that. But we had a flat, the mum's basement flat. Can you picture this flat in Buckingham Road? You go down the steps. You've got a coal shed in one side. You've got one room to the right, the left of you. Then you go to another back bedroom, and then you walk into the scullery or the larder. Outside, loo with a bloody mangle. Everybody had a mangle. You know what a mangle is?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, when you dry clothes.
Yeah. And an outside loo.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. But it was tough. It was tough. It was tough for us. You know?
Yeah. So how did you first get into art then, and why kind of? Why the artists that you've chosen in the past to kind of to copy? Why choose those artists, and how do you learn techniques of artists?
Yeah, good question. That is, when I was in Barnardo's, Barnardo's is fantastic. They encourage you to paint. They give you all the techniques, the oil paints that you need. But they did. I mean, they encouraged me. And I was working in oils when I was about 8 or 9. And I used to study and look at the old masters, you know, especially Caravaggio. And I thought, I can do a copy of that. I couldn't really, but I tried, you know. And I suppose I progressed until I became quite good at it. And then I remember when I left, after all the years in the homes, I left Goldings, you know. And you had a choice there. You had three trades: to be a cobbler. Can you imagine me as a cobbler? Cobbler's a bootmaker, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Or printing, or a gardener, whatever, yeah. I remember my Mr. Wheatley said, "Well, Max, you're going out into the wild world now. I hope you'll keep on straight and narrow." And I just knew where I was going. I wanted to be an artist. I wanted to paint. But unfortunately, I went home and my mum was living with her, not a nice character. So I ran away on a very a cold November night, and I got 10 and 6 in my pocket. So I got on the train. I didn't pay the fare, and I ended up in Paddington. And you know, in those days, in the 50s, there were lots of guest houses.
Yeah.
So I walked into this, and I told him I was an orphan. I was going to be picked up tomorrow by 6 French nuns. I don't know why I said it. Just made me get myself a room. Anyway, gave me a room. And what I did notice, I know this is a crime I'm going to admit to.
Right.
I saw there were gas meters in every room. So I screwed my gas meter. Right. Are you editing this?
Yeah, that's fine. Don't worry. Yeah. Right.
So I screwed my gas meter. Now, I didn't go to breakfast. I did everywhere else before I left. So I walked out of that little guest house with about, my pockets were so heavy with sixpences. And that was it.
Yeah.
And the only job you could get was circus. Right?
Yeah.
Right.
And just talk a bit. So I mean, you learnt how to kind of fend for yourself pretty quickly, didn't you? If you were getting a train, getting to guest houses, did you ever actually end up sleeping on the street ever? Or?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, you did. Yeah. What was that like?
The first time I was sleeping rough, or dossing, they called it, was in Dorchester, and I was sleeping in a railway carriage. So I was in Dorchester, and I walked up the high street at 5 o'clock in the morning, no money at all. And I saw this guest house open, so I nicked a chandelier. And I walked down with the chandelier in my case, and then suddenly the guy at the train station got suspicious, and he called the old Rozzers. I got picked up for nicking a chandelier.
Right.
And I ended up 3 months in Dorchester.
Right.
But you know when you're in Nick, you're respected for who you are, your crime.
Yeah.
I was an artist, so I was banged up, first of all, with a guy that was a stowaway from Curacao. Then I got banged, then the other one was two guys that had been ripping off the old pensions by watering down the paraffin, you know, for the old heaters.
Yeah.
And then I suddenly asked the governor, can I see the governor? He went, yes. He said, what do you want to do, Brandrett? They never called you Max, by the way.
Yeah.
I said, I want to paint. So they gave me a single cell. I was doing actually painting for all the legs in and all the screws.
Yeah. Screws. What portraits or what were you painting
for?
No,
just dogs and drawings and that.
Right.
So I used to get tobacco. I used to smoke in those days. So they'd give you, if you did a drawing of their dog or their child, you get a half ounce of gold Virginia. So right. That was it.
Brilliant. And we're going to talk a lot more about that in the second half. Join us in the second half. I'll be with Max Brandrett, the copyist, the artist, talking about his new Netflix series and his book as well.
And book.
Join us then. So back here with Max Brandrett, the artist, copyist, and also you were circus, not performer, but circus staffer, I would call
it, modern speak. Yeah, when I ran away from London, I got to Chipping Norton, King's Ride, Chipping Norton, and I walked into the winter quarters, and the guy said to me, what do you want, son? I said, so any jobs? He went, he said, how old are you? I said, I'm 16. He went, come on, get back to school. And I said, no, I need a job. He said, listen, you're so skinny, you wouldn't be able to do this job. He said, so there's nothing for you. So I walked away. He went, come here. He said, do you want to work with elephants? I went, I don't mind, sir. So he took me into this elephant tent. Would you believe, I'm 16 years old and I'm seeing these elephants there. And I then, of Chipfield Circus, I became part of the circus. And then, but one day I was painting and drawing, and Dickie Chipfield spotted me. He went, did you do these, Max? I went, yeah. He said, would you like to do pictures on the sides of the wagons and the trucks and the clowns and the menagerie? He went, yeah, I'll do that. So I started, then I became almost part of the family.
Yeah, okay.
I've been 3 years on there.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I love them.
What about the book then? So what stories are we going to find out about in the book, and how can we get the book once it's published?
That's to be, you know, we don't know the publisher. We've got two publishers, but let me just tell you, in the circus, you don't do a normal work. You don't do normal hours. When I was a flunky in Bertram Mills, Bertram Mills for the Christmas show in Olympia, and I was a flunky there. So, and I remember one day I was to be on the ring fence, and this new act came, the Primalettis, and they were a knife throwing act, you know, with the cowboys whipping it up with guns. And they brought in a big target in, and the girl was strapped to it, and he would take his knives and go boom, 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 you know, whatever they do. I didn't know that he'd actually going to dip them in petrol. So when he did that, my job was to take the knives out and blow them out. And don't forget, I've got all this gear on me. We've got a lovely powdered wig, white bow tie, lovely white gloves, got knee breeches, buckled shoes.
Yeah.
So I'm blowing away, and suddenly my bloody glove, my gloves are out of the light, and my hair's on fire. And who's in the audience that night was Hattie Jakes. She thought it was part of the show. She's laughing away. I really had a serious head wound there. I got taken to Hammersmith Hospital. But Hattie Jakes, you know Hattie Jakes, the actress, and John Le Mesurier with her family, she sent me a lovely box of chocolates and said, how is that ring groom? Is he fine now? And that was some of the stories there, you know?
Yeah. Well, so what happened there? You actually got burnt, did you?
Yeah.
All right.
My wig was a lie. I was running around the circus like a flame coming out of my head, you know?
So what about getting into art? And see, I know you did some artwork in the circus. How did you get into actual...
I left the circus.
Yeah,
and I left them in Sheffield, and I went to London, and I got a place in Cricklewood, and I thought I bought some old canvases because that's all you could afford, and I started to do pictures of Nelson and shipping scenes. Also, I got my guitar, so I ended up in Paulabella Road, And I thought, put my paintings there on a blanket, because I couldn't afford a stool. I thought, I picked the guitar. God, Mark, I only knew two bloody songs.
Yeah.
The Long and Dusty Road and A Lesson Too Late for the Learning.
Yeah.
And I thought, this guy said, oi, mate, he said, you keep doing the same bloody songs every week. I went, well, you haven't put any money in, so get lost.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I did my two song. And that's when I met some characters. But I want to talk about a character I met, which I'm sure one day he'll be remembered. On a Saturday morning, I did my show, and this guy turned up. He was about 80, right? He had a vest on, a big brown belt, and a big trousers, like demob things from the Navy.
Yeah.
And he said, hello. So he said, I love your paintings, he said. I said, who are you? He said, I am the great Raimondo. I said, who is that? He said, I'm an escapee artist. He said, I get out of any tight situation. And we became friends. So what he did about 12 o'clock in the morning, he went, this is how he used to do it. He'd go, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, could you just, by the way, my name is the great Raimondo. I'm an escape artist. My good friend here, who's a painter. I said, no, don't say that, because I'm forging pictures here, for God's sake. So anyway, the deal was, he got into a sack. He was chained up, and then he was put on the floor. Don't forget, he's 80 years old. And then he's struggling away, and he goes, Max, Max, what? I said, I can't get out. I said, what? He said, where my hand is, give me the other key. So I had to open this little slit and I hand him the key. And he'd take it out, he'd do the business, and he'd go, dee-dee-dee. And at the end of the day, he went, I'm so sorry, ladies and gentlemen, due to the inclement weather, the guy ropes have been tightened by the weather. So I love that. I love those sort of characters.
What else? I know you met the Craze. We've heard about that before. We were just saying off air that, you know, two of the people from the Cray era are still alive, aren't they, there?
Many.
Yeah.
Freddie Foreman is.
Freddie Foreman's one of them. Eddie Richardson, I think, probably,
yeah,
too.
Well, they were two
yeah,
different.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
But, yeah, Freddie Foreman, lovely guy. His son's a good actor, Jamie.
Yeah.
He's been on many programmes, yeah. Chris Ellis, you know, he's done a lot of those sort of movies, yeah.
Yeah. All right, so what about this, the film then? You've got two scripts. I mean, where can we see this, and when do you think?
Well, we think we're looking at two scripts. Tony Valentine is my ghostwriter. He's done a lovely job. But he, as I tell a story to you, I seem to be the people that I've met. I can't help that. I do all these, don't do all, not an actor, but he's got it dead, he's got it right, you know? You know, with these sort of people I've met, you know, like, but it's a lovely book. And it's be finished. We've got one more, half a chapter to do, and just do a bit of proofing.
And how do you go about doing that? Does he sit down and he writes notes? How do you go about...
No, he lives in Nottingham and does it on the phone.
Right.
So he goes all through what happened then.
Right.
When did you leave there? You know, that some of the stories are, I don't want to give all the story at the plots,
no,
you know, but there's some, he's a very, very good writer. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah. So he's just done through phone calls then, and then he just takes that. So he's just asking a series of questions. And,
yeah.
Interesting. I mean, what would we see in the film? Are we going to see some of the art? Are we going to see you in, I mean, you still do art, don't you? Are we going to see are you going to see an action painting?
No, there's no point, is there?
Right.
Because you hopefully you'll get some images of what I can do.
Yeah.
But Mark, I'm now not a forger. The word forger, you cannot fool them today.
No.
I said it to you before. In my day, you could. You know, we used to ring it, and we'd, you know. Do you know the story of how we used to do it? Can I go through that?
Yeah.
Right. Say we had a smudge or a painting.
Yeah.
Right. And I was with somebody like, I go with Sammy Cohen, one of the greatest con men I've ever met in my life. And we would do a picture on old canvas, and we'd go to sort of Lots Road or Bonham's or Phillips, and we'd go in, and you do the same story. Go, morning, sir. Got a smudge in the car, sir? Would you have a look at me? And they go, yes, sir. Yeah. You go, yes, we'll have a look. And you know, you used to bring in a lot of pot boilers, and you'd throw in a goodie. Or two goodies, right? And then you go, anyway, running through, thinking we're bloody peasants, for God's sake. You go, oh, quite interesting. What's that, sir? He said, this shipping scene. Oh, the one with the boats on it, sir. Because, you know. I said, Dad, he likes the one with the boats on it. So he goes, he said, where is it? I said, Albert Darby. He went, well, that sounds a good name. he said, what's it all about, sir? Do you know the... I said, yes. Painted Norwich School. Was it painted in Norwich, sir? Oh, God, when we did him up like a kipper. And he goes, oh, you've got a Samuel Palmer here, which was very rare.
Yeah.
You know, then we used to ring it. You know, ringing is? You used to go to the auction and bid it up, you know.
Yeah.
Not now, though. Don't do it now.
And was that easy to do? And how widespread was that? I mean, because I'm just thinking there's got to be a lot of fake paintings around. And I've heard this as well, that there are, you know, globally, there's a lot of forgeries, isn't there?
Well...
And a lot of people have got what they think's painting worth a few million quid on the wall, and it's worth a lot less than
probably
that.
Probably a few of mine, but...
Yeah.
I mean, I'm too old to go to Nick anyway. Is there a Nick for pensions? I don't know.
Yeah. There's a lot of fake art around, isn't
there? Listen, I know what you're saying, but you cannot get away with it today. There's too many experts. They can do... You'd said today, they can tell you the age of the paint, you know. We, in my day, you go back to 67, 68. You weren't even born then, were you?
No, not quite.
But you could fool them, not quite now.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're a little bit younger than that. But you could fool them, you could do that. Because, Tom Keating, you know when you crack a picture?
Yeah.
To crackling, can I give the secret away now? The secret is bead glue. Do you know what bead glue is?
Yeah, I've heard of it, yeah.
Right. So you take bead glue, and it's like scotch glue, it looks like lentils. So you'd buy a pound of that, or two pounds of it, you put it in a saucepan, cold water, overnight it goes to a jelly. Next morning, put it on your stove, it's like a soup. So you cut your picture over it, and then you go to a heater, not dry heat, electric heater, and then you would circulate the painting, keeping the heat going all the way out. And you can actually hear it cracking, goes, right? You look at it and think, yep, bit there more, bit there. Then you think, right, now you've got enough cracks in it. Over to your tap, it's a water base, and the water will take the bead glue off and leave all the cracks. Take your Hoover out, empty the Hoover on it, rub it in. All the cracks are filled with rubbish, you know, dark. Old varnish, old nails, in the back of the frame, done.
Thanks a lot, Max. All the best for the future. Cheers.
Good interview,
Thanks.
Isn't he?
Thanks.
He is good, isn't he?